most with the most.
Yo, you do the most. It's easy to do it.
Mr. Elijah Shaw.
What up, brother?
It is a pleasure to be here with you, man, during these times. We see that we have the physical distance going on, but the social connection is still there and the personal connection is still there.
Yeah, for sure.
So I appreciate you just taking some time to sit with me. For those who are on live, I know you're controlling it over there, but I hope you guys can hear us. If you can't, let E. Shaw know.
That's a good point.
If you got questions, you know, give them to E. Shaw, and then he and I will go. We'll do the Shaq and Kobe thing. Let's do
Ventrell hit me. He said he can see and hear us both, so that's great.
Perfect.
The disclaimer is we haven't done this before, so this is my first time kicking in the Zoom feed like directly into Facebook. So that's dope. And this is like the right now on this end, and we're gonna rebroadcast it later, but on this end it's the private alumni board. So it's, you know, it's just some like the familiar faces that a lot of the guys that you dealt with when you did the keynote address at the social we did in Atlanta.
Yes.
And of course, you know, interact with people all the time. So yeah, man. So this is our test, but at least right now I know they can see us and hear us. And then I should be able to move the screen over a little bit and be able to see the commentary as well. So.
Perfect. So I want to jump in. If you're ready to jump in, I just got a couple of initial questions I want to pose to you. During this time now, I want to know, what have you been doing in your field? Because you are a practitioner of this field at the highest level. What are the things that those who are engulfed in this profession that they could do during these times? Obviously, everyone's not working at the full capacity. There are no tours, no festivals going
on. Right.
What could they be doing right now besides reading the book? You know, I gotta push that. Besides reading the book, what could they be doing right now to help sharpen their skills during this time?
Well, brother, I mean, I think you're right. It's a crazy time. And of course, on the security front, a lot of our conversations are wrapped up around that in terms of what's happening right now and then trying to forecast for the future. And I think the big piece is, and I was just talking to a couple of the guys, I mean, just yesterday, I was talking to Malik and Ventrell, and I was saying to them that this is prep time now, you know what I mean? So before the big game, this is that prep time. So now you can get right mentally and physically, even if the thing that's, you know, might be suffering right now is your pockets. But if you can hold out for a second, and I guess the good thing about our profession, a lot of guys understand that you have to put some stuff away for a rainy day, because there is some inconsistencies in the field. So sometimes you're working a lot, and then sometimes the phone might not ring. So
right.
we might be a little conditioned for that more so than other people, because there's some ebbs and flows in our industry. And so the hope is that you've got something stashed away for a rainy day if you're not working currently. And then you use this time here to build up and plan out whatever your next moves are. Even if we just talk just about like touring, if you think about it, for those agents that work specifically with artists that are heavy in the music industry and heavy on the touring side, those artists aren't getting the income and the revenue that they were normally getting. So that means that they're sitting at home right now, they're chomping at the bit, you know, 4 months from now, 6 months from now. So the next time you go out on the road, or the next time they have the opportunity to go on the road, they're never coming home because they got to refill those coffers. You know what I mean?
Right,
and so that creates opportunities for us. And so, you know, it's survival of the fittest. So why don't you use this time right here to get fit, like mentally and physically?
Like those shiny things back there.
Oh, you familiar with those though?
Oh yeah, I got a few. I don't know if you can see him back there.
Okay, all right.
I got a few. I don't know if you see those over there. I got a few back there.
Oh, okay, all right. You're OG in the game, so you know. I get that.
Been doing this for a little bit.
Yeah, you've been doing it for a minute, and the funny part is, cats don't really know your pedigree though. So. You know,
they don't.
You wear a few different hats, so that works out well, man. So I think people are now finding us in the new joint, and we had got kicked out of the other one. I think it's just the Facebook connection, so at random points it's going to drop out. But is what it is. We'll make it work. So this is the trial run. But did that make sense? What I was saying though.
Yeah, with the ebb and flows.
Yeah. Right. Exactly.
Yeah, so
and just you know, like this should really be prep time for a lot of people, man. Like that's where the winners are going to come out on the other side of this.
Right, I agree with you. I want to take it to a different angle now. Just you guys were on tour for a while, right? The principal that you were working with on tour for a while. Do you now at this point in time go back, whether it's you and Sam or you yourself, go back and kind of watch the footage per se? Or the game film and kind of say, hey, this is what went right. This is what went wrong. You know, I had the opportunity to come and see you guys live and in living color at Madison Square Garden. Do you go back and talk to, you know, the security people at Madison Square Garden and say, hey, what went right? What went wrong? What can we do better? Do you take this time now to kind of go back and watch this game tape and game film like you said, you're going to be another, as soon as we get through this, you're going to be back out of the road, and you're going to be on there for a while. Mm-hmm. Are there things that you can go back and make better or double up on?
Yeah, 100%. But that wasn't the pandemic that initiated that for me. I always do that. Now we don't do it so much, you know, with the venues or anything like that until it's closer to, you know, when we have to interact with them. But what we're doing it internally. And just what you said is reviewing the footage and reviewing the protocols that we have and refining them, and that's something that's been kind of standard operating procedure for us for a while now. But this again, having some downtime allows you to really focus on that and kind of pick out the things that you can do better, that you can change. And again, once we go into this new season. Whenever we get on the other side of whatever this craziness is, once we go into this new season, bro, there's going to be so many opportunities. But this is the perfect time to start off on the right foot. You know what I mean? So have your plan in place. And I'm not trying to sell anybody a dream because, again, if there's a lot of cats that's sitting on the bench right now because there isn't any work, they're at that starting gate too. So, you know, so somebody's going to be right out the gate trying to get in Philly's slot. So that's why I'm saying if you can put yourself in the best possible position. And, of course, like learn from the past. Learn from your past mistakes. Learn from others. You know, I always see, you know, somebody post something on social media on, like, YouTube or, you know, something. And then people will look at it and laugh at it, you know, some kind of mistake. Some problems or something like that, that somebody, you know, in the security field made. But instead, when I look at it and I see, all right, here was an issue. How could this situation have, you know, if you had approached it differently, how can you succeed in that same situation? So I look at it as a white paper, you know what I mean? I look at it as an example to be able to say, all right, if I was in there, not playing Monday morning quarterback, particularly for social media, but if I was in those shoes there and I was faced with that same encounter, what could I do different? And the fact that somebody had that situation in front of them, that gives you something to feed off of, you know what I mean? And so so when I see all these things about, you know, this dude punched somebody or this dude got hit or this dude pushed somebody off the stage, people are looking at the humor in that, or people are looking to kind of down somebody for a mistake that they did, or just some, you know, just something they didn't know in terms of tactics. What I'm looking at is, all right, if the stage is this level and the guy approached from here, where were the weak points that got him to that stage? You know what I mean? If the guy tripped on his own and fell off a 6-foot stage, what's the medical response going to be? You know what I mean? So you can take that same thing, and if you just change your perspective a little bit, then it's not funny, it's not salacious, it's not down on somebody, but there's a learning and there's a lesson in there that's something that you can apply to yourself and your team.
I love that perspective, because I feel like sometimes, and I think you've said this, you taught me this, you can't just react without having some kind of opportunity to kind of have seen the play already, that you know what to do in proper step, and there's a proper formation. Instead of, you know, being on the defensive, when you react, now you're reacting from muscle memory, saying, all right, this is what I could do. This is
right.
I remember, you know, he told me to do this, and now it's kind of second nature.
Right.
You know, so going back to that film, I think it's super important. In this time, I want to talk about, you're very adamant about physical strength, physical presence in terms of what you're doing. Not that you have to be the biggest guy or the strongest guy, but right now, what are the things that are you, that you're doing to stay fit, both mentally and physically?
Okay, all right. I believe in it, bro. And one, because I'm not getting any younger, so that's one thing. But I just believe in optimizing. You know what I mean? If we're gonna be in this game, and we're gonna be in this game for some longevity, like, we got to put in the work. You know what I mean?
Right.
And so, just because, you know, this pandemic is going on, we can't just count it out. We have to still be, you know, think about our fitness and how we're gonna function once we get back around our clients. And so with that, you just got to modify the things you have. I thought I was living good, bro, because even though, you know, I was back at home, I was like, okay, I know all of the big gyms are closed, but I got a gym in my building. And then when they shut the gym in my building down, I was like, oh, man. And, you know, and I spent a couple days trying to figure it out, but then I figured out, you know, how I'm going to do the workout at the house, you know what I mean? I'm going to move some stuff out of the way, and I'm going to set it up. But part of the thing that works for me is structure. So that is, like, okay, wake up at this time, you know what I mean? Get your nutrition at this time. Get your meditation at this time. Yeah, I meditate. You know, and then, you know, get your workout in at this time. You know, get all of these things. But if I have that structure, then I can get it done. And then the other thing is the accountability part. So for me, I'm in a workout chat. And so I'm in a chat with other executive protection professionals. And we post the workouts that we're doing. We post the things that we eat. We post tips in there. You know what I mean? And we motivate each other, which is basically the most important thing. And so there might be times where, you know, I'm on the couch. I hadn't worked out for the day. You know, I had a long day doing some other things. And I'm just like, yo, I can just do it tomorrow. And I look at my phone and I see these guys are getting it in. And I'm like, nope, no excuses.
Gotta get it.
I'm on it. So, yeah, so the accountability thing is really important as well.
I think the accountability part is super important, because we talked about this in Atlanta at the event. Being able to network and rubbing elbows, that you hold yourself accountable, you surround yourself with people who will hold you accountable. Now you have a group of people that are super successful, that they're like-minded and trying to do what, you know, what they're doing. How about, because you and I practice a plant-based diet, how important is it now, especially moving forward? Mm-hmm. You know, there's been so much talk about how this thing started with this COVID virus and eating. You're going overseas. You're going to different countries. Mm-hmm. How important is it to not only watch what you eat, but putting the proper things in your body?
Yeah. Well, here's a first caveat to that. So one is, you know, there's obviously a big debate between people like plant-based versus, you know, the carnivores of the world. Bro, I don't have if you know, I eat a steak a day, every day. I did 10 egg whites a day, every day. So I know about eating meat, you know what I mean? And I was doing that for nutritional purposes. So when I went to a plant-based diet, I did that for nutritional purposes. So whatever it is that you're doing, as long as you have the right intent and you're not like fooling yourself, you know what I mean? Like, then you can find success in that. So if you're going to, you know, when I was eating meat, I was trying to eat clean, you know what I mean? And then that's what gradually took me to where I am right now. But it was just like, okay, I'm going to eat farm raised, or I'm just going to eat, you know, chicken breasts or things I prepare myself. You know what I mean? So there were these stages. But to your point is, all I'm trying to do is optimize. And so that's going to keep me as fit as possible, to keep me operationally as long as possible so that I can succeed in the things that I'm doing. And if I'm going overseas, particularly if I'm going overseas with a client, I can't afford to be down. So I got to do things that are going to make sure that I'm functioning as close to peak capacity as I can. And so part of that is the fuel that you put in your body. So I try and be super sensitive to that. You know, do I have some cheat days or do I have some cheap things, cheap meals or something like that? Yeah, but I usually try to have the discipline because I know that I got to stack the deck as much as possible in my favor because, you know, one, I'm not getting any younger, and two, we got a really serious job to do, so why would I make it tougher on myself? You know, yes, that hamburger with the double cheeseburger with all the cheese dripping out the side. All that. Yeah, that tastes super good or whatever, but, you know, like, is that really helping my overall mission? You know what I mean? And I think if there's anything, bro, I try and keep an eye on the big picture. You know what I mean? And so if I'm looking at the big picture, I want to stay healthy physically. I want to stay healthy mentally. I want to constantly keep myself engaged. I want to be making smart financial decisions. I want to make smart business decisions. I want to have strong relationships. I mean, you know what I mean? Like all these things, they sound aspirational. But if I'm going to aspire to it, why wouldn't I do it? You know what I mean? So that's my first. When I have a new relationship with a client, you know, they're kicking my tires, I'm kicking their tires. We're filling each other out. But they're going to have a sense of who I am. And that person is consistent all the way through. You know what I mean? I'm never going to, you know, all of a sudden, you know, come out of my bag and, you know, show up to work, you know, high. You know what I mean? Like, it's just not going to happen. So because of that, there's not even a question. So if there's some things that I don't do, they just respect it, man. Like, I'm trying to go back and think about similar situations. And most of those involve, like, okay, here the girls, like, yo, E, it's okay to go party or something. You know, I'm going to be fine. I'm over here in the VIP. Enjoy yourself or whatever. But, like, I don't want to do any of that because if I give you this person on Monday and this person on Tuesday, when I need to be serious, I need you to be focused, you're going to think, oh, I've got my homie Elijah that I'm talking to right now. And then, of course, something you know, really bad can happen. So I think it's about making sure that you know who you are early in the relationship as you present yourself to your client, and then they'll pick up on that.
Now, moving forward.
Hold on real quick. Because Michael Brown's in the chat here, and he said, like, that's something that's established at the initial interview. And I think that's more what I'm saying. You know what I mean? Like for me, you know, it really depends on the client. Some of those people, that initial interview is a formal one. You know, this is what I do, right. I don't do, et cetera. Sometimes that's just informal, and that's just they pick up on who you are and what you are just by being around you for it. You know what I mean? Like, I never, when I work with a client, and I deal with the doors, right? I don't want them jumping in and out of the cars. But I don't go to a client, I go, hey, I'm going to deal with the doors, just stay there until I open the door. I never do that because they're grown. Like, they know how to open the door, so I don't want them to feel like that. Instead, I do it by example. Every time the car comes to a stop, I get out, I walk, and I block their door from opening. After 2-3 times of that, they realize they can't just walk right out the door. Then they get it. They don't even, you know what I mean? So I think, again, that's formal interview versus an informal interview, but the effect is the same. You know, you can train your clients into who you are and what you do, and they'll respect that.
And I like that answer. And Mike, thank you so much for sharing that. Because there's so many gray areas, right? You may have a client who says, you know, all right, it's just family and friends. And, you know, we're having a celebratory drink or a celebratory toast. In those moments, you know, you still have to try those are, that's what I'm getting at. Like in those moments where it's intimate and mm-hmm. it's maybe with the family and wife and children or husband and children. And mm-hmm. they're like, hey, champagne glasses are going around. And they're mm-hmm. like, we want to toast because we, you know, we got the Oscar or we got the Grammy or whatever it is, new contract or platinum album, you know, in those moments, like you said, you may have established that, but how do you deal with that particular moment where you're like, can I let my hair down? Or do you stay to being, like you said, not homie Elijah, but professional Elijah?
Well, I'm going to give it to you like this. So in that sense, all I can speak about is the encounters that I have and how I do it. Other people might have, you know, different relationships with their clients or different methods. For me, again, they already have a sense of my personality. So I will pass on the things that that aren't going to work in the long run in terms of the relationship, the long-term relationship I want to have with my client. I'm going to pass on it even at the point of being the butt of the joke. You know what I mean? Oh, Elijah, ain't nothing going to happen, man. Just go ahead and have a drink. Nah, bro, I'm not going to drink or whatever. Laugh at you, you know what I mean? Okay, bro, you'll know what you're missing. Whatever that is, you know what I mean? Like, so whatever's going to work in that particular relationship to get me out of that situation, I'm going to do it. So now, I don't want you to think that, like, again, you know, I use the term real world versus textbook. You know, if the client says, hey, you know, we're getting ready to sit down for Thanksgiving dinner, we want you to join us, and we're at their house, and I'm like, no, I'm going to go sit in the car, and then mom comes out and say, hey, we really like you to join us. I'm going to go sit down for Thanksgiving dinner. You know what I mean? There's some people who are like, nope, can't cross that line, et cetera. So I think I and hopefully I didn't sound like a contradiction, but it's the boundaries that you set there, you know? And if your ethics or your morals or, again, that big picture doesn't change, then that's fine. So now this will take it full circle to one of the things that I always, you know, talk to people about having their niche, you know, something that they excel in. And one thing you can't lose, bro, is if you have a stronger medical background, some kind of medical background that's, you know, maybe one step above like first aid and CPR. If you have something above that, all of a sudden, again, most of these clients now are thinking about, you know, illness now, you know what I mean? And so if you have something that puts you that step above, all of a sudden you are now dramatically more valuable to them, you know, than, you know, the jewelry and the cars that they would buy because they see that it was real. Like, you know what I mean? If they go back to, you know, February, March, April, they see it's real out here. So if, like, now all of a sudden, if I got a guy on my team who, you know, has advanced medicine on him, you know, shout out to Raphael, who's one of the instructors on the ICON board, and he's been preaching this, bro, for years talking about this. And now everybody's thinking about it. But if you have these credentials in your back pocket, it just makes you more invaluable.
And I love the niche perspective because I feel like a lot of people downplay what it is that they do, what they're good at. You know, some people are like, oh, you're a great swimmer. Like, that you should make sure that that's in your, like, that's something to talk about. Like, you're a great swimmer. Like, you never know if there's a client. You just, you know, I get up and I like swimming. Like, it's a great part of the program that I do to just stay fit. You know, the simplest things. You know, speaking a different language. You know, shout out to my brothers from Africa that, you know, that are down with ICON. Like, being able to have another language or two in your back pocket. Being a great driver. You know, I know I'm not talking anything foreign to some of those who are watching that are on the
board. Like, listen, this is positive reinforcement, though. Like, that's why I wanted to chat with you, particularly broadcast that live in the ICON group.
It's so important, E, because if I can, I found that two things that we talked about in Atlanta, and I know that you're a big advocate. Networking is so important. There are two shows that I ended up having a couple of years ago on Fuse just because the art of networking is something that I hold near and dear to my heart. You know, it's just who I am. And I feel like you are one degree of separation or even half of that. So if you rub elbows and just simply just introduce yourself, hey, my name is June Archer. I heard you're Elijah Shaw, and you do X, Y, and Z. Just want to know if I could just, you know, share an email with you and we could go back and forth. Yeah, right. It may be odd sharing a phone number initially, but an email back. Hey, well, you know what? Oh, you're on IG? Well, I'm on IG too. Let's follow each other. I'll just DM you. We can start a conversation there. Only to realize that there are opportunities later on down the line because you're not doing it for the immediate. You're doing it for the, hey, you know what? Let me see how much mileage we can get out of this that we could build a lifelong relationship, a lifelong friendship, lifelong business relationship.
Yes.
Right? So if you do the networking piece, it just makes super sense. But then when you talk about the niche, right? For me, it's I was an artist turned executive. So when I talk to people and I'm trying to, you and I were just joking a few minutes ago about these shiny things on the wall.
Right.
I wasn't able to get these plaques by osmosis. Like I was an artist. So I know about the recording process. I know about the writing process. I know about being able to work with an artist. I had the opportunity to work with Chris Brown, Mario, Omarion, before they were established. Because I knew the game. And if you understood, if I don't put that out, like you said, we're talking about pedigree. If you don't put what your skills and what it is that you're great at, someone will go by you one day and say, oh man, Elijah, I didn't know you knew how to play ball. I had this client. He loved playing ball, but we couldn't find nobody there. So we end up going with this guy.
Yes, bro.
And you're like, but I play ball. I'm very good. I turned out a scholarship to play ball. And you're like, but you never told me that, E. Like, E, you know CPR, didn't that? Because we ended up getting this other guy. Because I didn't know. I just figured that you didn't know, so you didn't say anything. Mm-hmm. But close mouths don't get fed.
You know, Sam, and amongst all his other great qualities, I mean, Sam will tell you, I just had him on a plane for one day to fly to Mexico because I was working on stuff in Mexico, and he speaks Spanish fluently. And at that point there, I needed him to make sure that the communications that were happening on this particular day, I was out there for a week or 10 days or something like that. But I flew him out for one day because it was a very important day. And I wanted to make sure that the things that needed to be communicated were communicated effectively. Jumped on a plane, flew out there with me all day. I don't even think he went to sleep. Got back on the plane the next morning to fly back home. But he had a specific skill set that, of course, I knew about. He had a specific talent in this, you know what I mean?
Right.
He's, you know what I mean? And you know, he's fluent in Spanish. But there's a lot of guys who might also be fluent in Spanish, and I don't know that, you know? And you got to be able to communicate that.
I think it's important, especially during this time, as you're going about your day, think about what you're doing. Some guys that love IT, like we are heavy on the technology because of being at home now. Like if you're good at IT, if you're good at hooking up a broadcast, like these are the things that moving forward we're going to need. Like, so just think about during the day while you wake up and brush your teeth and you're making your toast and you're going about your day and you're trying to fix things around the house and you're being handy, you may pick up a different you know, skill set that you're like, oh man, kind of nice with the hammer, right? So who knows what that can yield.
Yeah.
I want to talk to you about, and I don't know if there's any more questions out there with anybody else, but I want to touch on this piece. We talked about, and you know, jokingly we're talking about meditation. And I think it's super important. I think anxiety is at a high level right now. And we just talked about horses and equestrian. And what I learned recently was some of the best therapy and meditation comes with equine therapy. It's really dope. I got some information on it. I definitely got to share it with you.
Okay.
I learned at this place called Ebony Horsewomen in Hartford, Connecticut. Actually going back, as soon as everything blows over, I have, you know, 6 horse riding lessons that are coming to me from supporting the organization and learning about this therapy. How important is it right now? There are plenty of apps. I don't know if there's an app that you could share with anybody who's watching or listening. How important is it, and what can they do? If it's not an app, if there's some music, whatever it may be, what can you share with those who feel like, you know, being indoors is really giving them high anxiety? They're itching, you know, and this is part of the ebb and flow that you talk about in the book.
There
are going to be these times. What can they do?
Well, first of all, as I start talking about this, there's going to be people listening that know I'm not lying because I hit them up all the time about where I'm at in my meditation stuff. And, you know, I'm sure some people, their eyes might start rolling like, yeah, okay, whatever. But, you know, for me, that's a part now that I try and pay attention to, because again, I'm trying to optimize. So, you know, in the executive protection industry, you know, very alpha, very macho. So you don't want to maybe portray to people that you're not, you're too in tune with your feelings. But, you know, I'm at a point where I'm like, nah, I'm trying to be more in tune with my feelings, and I this could be benefit you as well. So, and that's not in a preachy way. It's just in a way that, like, this helps me focus. And I think I'm a pretty focused individual. So if you need to focus, or you think you might need some more assistance in focusing, you might want to try this. I say, all I say, bro, is that I started meditating, like, for real, maybe about 2 years ago. I always started meditating. You know, you just think, you just, okay, I'm quiet, I'm cut the lights off, or, you know, I stay in the cell and I'm meditating.
Right.
But for me, what I started doing was guided meditation. Somebody telling me what I need to be thinking about and how to kind of get in the zone or whatever. This bro, it's helped me out, like, tremendously. And I do it every day. And remember that workout chat I told you that we're in? So with the guys, yeah, man, when I, you know, I finish my session, I just send it into them. Again, I'm not just saying, hey, this works for me, you know, but this is what I got through. And again, that's more checks and balances for me. And I know a couple of them that checked it out or whatever. And that might not be the thing for anyone, but like you said, what you tried worked for you. And I use an app, it's called Headspace. And then somebody had put me up on it. It was like free at first. And I tried the little sample thing. And
right, I'm gonna write that down.
Yeah, Headspace. You start off for like 5 minutes a day or something, and then now I just build up, bro, and it's just a part of my day. So usually when I get out of bed, first thing I do, mm-hmm, I meditate, and then I go about to start the rest of my day. And I remember Gary sent me something, bro, like, you know, like RZA has made like a meditation mixtape, you know, with like real beats on it or whatever. So if, you know, if you're like, yo, that meditation thing sounds kind of, you know, Far Eastern or something like that, well, you can get hip-hop music and get into the zone. I didn't listen to it. It was kind of dope. You know, so it just whatever works for you, bro. And, you know, one of the guys on here said, like, you know, he zones out playing piano. You know, he can play piano. And so whatever it is that works, but the thing that it allows me to do is that it allows me to kind of, there's a billion things that go off in my head all the time. I'm always thinking about the next project or the next plan or make sure my guys are good and, you know, all these different things, right? Particularly now with this, you know, pandemic going on. So the meditation helps me kind of still things, you know, kind of stills my mind. There's an alumni we have on the board, Jason Polston, and he's in the mental health profession. And bro, I'd love to just drag him out. He's a real behind the scenes dude, but I would love to just drag him out, because me and him have conversations like one-on-one and have him just talk about the effects of like something like this, where you're, you know, you're social distancing or you're in isolation or, you know, you don't know where the next paycheck comes from and all these, you know, how am I going to pay the rent? Like those have an effect on everybody, including protectors, you know what I mean? And one of the things that I wrote in the book is that a lot of the stresses that we go through are similar to the stresses of first responders. So if you think about, you know, the fire department or the police and the things that they're constantly dealing with problems and they're constantly dealing with issues and they're constantly having to be the go-to person and make things right, a degree of that happens with us protectors. And so we're used to being in control of something, and this is a thing we have no control over except for, you know, what we can do ourselves. So that feeling of powerlessness. And then being in a room or in your house or wherever it is, I don't care how big your house is. And I talk to clients that have huge houses, and they're still feeling it. Yeah, exactly. They're still feeling it. So I don't care how big your house is, you know. But yeah, there's you definitely have to take care of yourself. You know what I mean? And however that's whatever's going to work for you. And I would just say, like, you know, the guys that are really into shooting, they go shoot all the time. The guys that are in the martial arts, you know, they go do martial arts. The guys that are in the fitness, they go lift weights, you know, but just how you take care of all of that other stuff, you just take care of your mental as well. But bro, man, thank you for your time, bro.
Likewise. I look forward to more of these conversations. You guys keep these questions going. We're going to continue these conversations. And E, man, thank you for being a beacon of light and inspiration for all of us, man. I know you respect what I do, but trust me, I love and respect what you're doing. Keep doing it. And keep posting those pictures of you all over the globe, because I know you're missing it right now.
Bro, yo, this is the longest I've been in one place in forever, man. Like, forever. But it's good for me, though. It's good for me.
That means you should be editing more photos. You got time to edit more photos.
100%. I got them on deck, man.
That's what I'm talking about. E, all right, I love you, big bro.
Yo, much respect, bro. I'll talk to you soon.
Yes, sir, big bro.